slow. Hello, Shalom.
Hello? Hello?
Hey, Shalom, it's Tazadaq.
Shalom, how are you?
I'm pretty good, how are you?
Huh?
I said I'm pretty good, how are you?
That's wonderful, it's amazing. I was just looking into the sun to do my exercise. And I was trying to find the book because I had my questions, but I'll formulate them from memory. I don't want to keep your time because I know you're busy.
Oh no, you had them written down somewhere?
I had them written down, but my place is like a tornado, means the spirit doesn't want us to be there, and I want to leave this immediately as possible.
Alright.
To a warmer place without encumbrances and attachment, erroneous encumbrances and attachments.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, I gotta say this, like, you know, I can't give you any sort of legal advice. I could actually only advise you how I would actually handle a situation or what I would do.
Yeah.
So, I mean, with that being said, like, what's the situation that you're having, or what is it that, you know, you're having issues with?
I'm in public housing, and we have to put in the lease, and the lease is done as an affidavit, and the affidavit was swear, and I wanted to. I'm taking over from my mom. You know, she filled out her application wherever she filled out her application. And so they, they go in and they look in your background and they find something they want. You know, they want to terminate our lease. I would like to leave. I really would. I just, she didn't want us to leave without having a location. But it's time to go. That's why I'm going to put in my application, and I want to give them as much as possible. I know when I give them all of the stuff, they always come back to exact more, or they want us to sign off on things. They want us to release them from stuff. They want us to sign off things like release them from, like, debt. You know, they got all these different, this new stuff that I'm not familiar with, to sign to release them. So I always sign off and then I put my all rights reserved, that's it. That's the credit card company to have sent out. They send me out the instruments, but because I did not know how to properly respond to them, and because I'm not a secure money creditor, I'm just trying to figure out how to respond correctly in the paperwork.
Right. So I'm just, I guess I'm trying to get clarity here. So you're dealing with some sort of lease and public housing, and then the other thing is...
And they want some verification, and so they want more information. I was like, well, you've been doing this, you know, so income verification. And so they want me to provide all that. Stuff that I thought I should provide years ago, so you wanted to find out if I had additional to look it up, you know?
Right.
And so now they want, and so they've given me notices, and they give a warning, the notice to vacate, and they try to serve me with termination. And so my mother's ill, and I don't want to just drag her around. So I know you can't, I want to do this thoughtfully so that I can give them everything. But then when they come back with whatever it is that they come back with, I want to be able to properly use this property.
So what exactly is it that they're trying to verify?
Income.
Right.
Income.
So basically it's like if you make a certain amount of income, you may no longer be entitled to reside there at that particular location. I think that's what I'm, like, getting from this. So this is probably why they want the verification.
Yes, and so I'm not employed. I'm not making it. My mother's on a fix. And I don't know.
So let me, is there a specific reason that you don't actually want to like give them, like, you're actually staying on their property, is that correct? You know, pretty much as long as you're on their property, then they could actually, unless they're asking you for something specifically, that they're actually not asking anyone else, and then you feel as if you're being discriminated against, then, you know, you may have something within that. But if they pretty much ask someone, you know, or other people that really stay on those premises, you know, the same type of questions and for the same, you know, documents to verify that they're making what they're really making, then there's not much that actually can be done about that, because that's private property. So in order to make that, then you'll have to, like, really adhere to their terms. Or they could say, you know what, then you got to vacate the premises.
Okay. So, I understand that's the way, because before I tried to show them my choice, they wanted, I understand, so they're nice, but that's not private, is it? I thought it was public.
What's that?
It's public property.
What do you mean, the public housing?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, but when they use the term public, it doesn't refer to the same sort of public that we're actually used to. That's public listed in common parlance. For example, like, they'll tell you that, like, a city park, they'll refer to it as a public park. But then, if you're actually on that park, like at the hours, when they tell you that the park is actually supposed to be shut down, even though they say it's for the public, then the city, which is actually the entity that's actually in charge of that, could actually bring charges on you for trespassing. So it's kind of like the same thing with that, the housing. Even though they're using the term public housing, it's not really that. It's, you know, it's still some you know, organization behind it that's really in charge of that particular set of housing.
That's right. There's a company then. Okay. All right. Thank you for that clarity. Okay. You're right. That's the clarity I need. And the other thing is,
but they intentionally confuse you. They want to confuse you like that. That's why they use the word public housing. But then when you look at the other side, see, the real public is like you and I, right? So, you know, so if I could give you like a little better understanding, like, say if you was a person that was actually a hairstylist and I came to you and I got my hair done, that would be on a public side, because I went to you and I asked you to do my hair and I had to, you know, pay you. I gave you some money. That's on a public, actually, that's on a private side. But for that to be publicly, it would have to be some type, you would actually have to own like a large corporation of those, and you have like businesses all over, then that would consider to be a public organization. It would be like a corporation. So that, since that's on the public side, I wouldn't really be under obligation to pay you because of a public debt that they actually accumulated on the public side. But on the private side, between you and I, we're supposed to pay each other with this money that they call, you know, like Federal Reserve notes. But that's on the private side. But on the public side, we're supposed to be able to discharge that because of HJR, House Joint Resolution 192, and Public Law 7310. So that's the real distinctions of the public and the private. The public is really the federal government and these large corporations, and the private side is us. But they teach us just the opposite.
Public.
Well, I mean, if they're incorporated, then they're public. See, the games, I mean, it's little things that'll throw you off. Like,
yeah.
Kings County is not the same as the County of Kings. Like, if you see a document and it has the County of Kings on it, it's not talking about Kings County in Brooklyn. It's talking about the corporation that's actually taking that over. So most of these states has actually incorporated. So they answer to the federal government. So it's like they're on the public side now as well. This is why they use different laws and stuff on us when we go into the courts. Because it's public.
So as I say, if you give them something and you let them know, hey, the other stuff you want to find is in the public record, and but they have for years ignored it, and then now they're going through because somebody else is eavesdropping and informing,
right?
Them that, oh, this person, you know, we're doing this thing, you know, this person's doing this, but they're not doing what they're supposed to, so they're eavesdropping and actually stalking and following you, listening to your conversation, trapping you, tagging you, trapping you with, you know, when you go out, tracking your phone. And having open lines, when you get online, you can hear an open line at night, interfering with you at night, you know.
Well, I mean, all of that's illegal. For that to be done, there has to be, you know, like a court order to actually order this type of thing. Like, if someone's doing that and they don't have a court order, then that's considered to be unlawful. It's not lawful.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, but if someone else is trying to tip them off, and then all of a sudden they're asking you for specific documents and so on and so forth, then, I would actually stand on that. The first thing that I would say is everyone required to do this. If not, then you're actually discriminating against me. And if you continue, then I may be compelled to bring civil charges against you. Because if they're asking you for something just from something that someone says, like, you know, like, which is hearsay, then it's probably really not legal. I mean, because if you ask one person for something, you got to ask everyone for that.
That's right. Okay. I thank you so much. I appreciate the work that you do, because it's just, you know, even like you said, people go to school for all these years, and they still don't know who was the first black president. They don't know whether Constitution of a Republic, you know, we don't know nationality, we don't know ethnicity, we don't know domicile. When you ask, even in school, even if you take a course, now when are we going to really learn how to do proper work? Because you like something wrong with you.
Right. Now, one of the things that I would do, sister, is like if I feel that I was being harassed, then I would probably turn that into like a civil case. Because sometimes the best defense is a good offense. Like, if someone comes after you, then what you should probably do, if it's me, is I would go after them. So, and I wouldn't go after the organization. I would find the person that's actually sending me these documents, and I would go after them as an individual. Because if you go after an organization, they're usually protected by some sort of bond, you know, that, you know, they're secured by. So if you sue, you end up suing for their bond that they're protected by. But if you sue the individual, then they no longer actually have that draw. And usually if you go after them as an individual, that's a whole different ball game.
And if you can show and prove, meaning that if you have pictures, if you have recordings, and
right,
if you have scheduled as to you be somebody else be.
Right.
So then, as you sleep, or your radiation level in your place, or the acoustic sounds are extremely high.
Right. Right. I mean, if I thought these people was doing this, like every time that I communicated with them, it would actually be recorded. You know, if you're recording someone and it's part of your own conversation, then that recording is considered to be legal. Because if it's your own private conversation, it's considered to be admissible in court. Right. I mean, if you really believe that that's been happening, and there's no court order in place, then I mean, those are actually really serious charges, because you can't just tap someone's phone, or, you know, invade their laptop or something like that. There has to be a court order for things like that, you know.
Okay, and there's a way for me to see if there's a court order, right? There's a way for me to.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, otherwise. Even if they try to use something like that, it wouldn't be admissible in court. It was considered to be illegal evidence, so it wouldn't be admissible. Like, if they use something like that, even if it was found that, you know, you was guilty of it, but it was done illegally, then it's not admissible in court, and then you could actually just get the entire thing thrown out and dismissed. And then, you know, turn around and do a countersuit because an invasion of privacy. You know, you have according to the Fourth Amendment, we're entitled to freedom of liberty, which means we're supposed to be able to go, you know, go where we want, you know, be free to pretty much do what we want as long as it doesn't injure anyone else or anyone's property. So the only time something like that is admissible is if they believe that you're actually guilty of a crime or about to commit a crime. Then that's when their probable cause come in.
Okay, it's probable cause. So if you in your privacy get upset about something, if you say something and they say, see, this person say, you know, something. I said, but you know what? But if somebody's all night throwing stuff, doing stuff to provoke, and it may not be detectable, somebody else is detectable, so they can cause you to do something, so they can say, see.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. But I wouldn't let them provoke me if I was you, like, because the moment that you allow someone to make you angry, then essentially you're giving them control over you, and you shouldn't give anyone that much power over you, you know, because what they say usually don't mean anything anyways. If someone tries to get in your skin, they're trying to irritate you, that means something you're doing is important to them, or you're affecting their life some way. That means that you're important in their life. Or it's just envy, you know? So it's not worthy of being acknowledged.
You're right. You are absolutely right.
Yeah. I mean, for someone, I've had people like that. Some people, you know, you got to realize that some people wake up each day and they're not content unless they can make someone else feel miserable so they can make themselves feel better. It's a shame, but it's that way.
Right.
Right.
Okay. That's why I wanted, I was, me and my mom and her together so we could just lawn in the sunshine, you know, where we need to stay in the sunshine, connecting with the Most High.
Right.
And focus on what we just stay focused on. And I feel that the Spirit telling us to just be, you know.
Right.
Because, you know, she didn't want to feel like nobody was chasing her. That's what her, she was. Ain't nobody gonna take me. Man, Wagner got me this apartment.
Right.
So the other thing was when they send you the instrument out, the certificate, the coupon, cards and things of that nature to be able to respond to them, but be in a correct standing, right?
Well, I mean, well, I think what you're talking about is the acceptor for value. So, I mean,
A for V, and R for V.
Yeah, right. A for V, acceptor for value. That's what that acronym's for. But really, to do that, you're supposed to be exempted from levy. Now, here's the thing with that. Like, that is on their records that is lawful to do that, because if you, you know, when you get off the phone with me, Google House Joint Resolution 192. It'll tell you in, you know, 1933 under Franklin Delano Roosevelt, all real money was actually taken out of circulation, which was gold and silver. So along with that, the people actually inherited a right to discharge all public debts. But that's the key thing right there. It has to be a debt and it has to be on the public side. So that doesn't mean that you could go to some private entity and try and settle with debts. And this is where some people get in trouble with. They're not really studying that House Joint Resolution.
So what if public money, which I don't know what public money is anyway, because if the government bail out the banks and they, you know, and there's a, my understanding there's supposed to be like a warranty too that they're supposed to pay back. I just try to figure out more. I looked it up, but I had all that on my device.
Well, I mean, there is no real money in circulation right now. A Federal Reserve note is not money, and it may sound crazy, but if you look at the definition of money in a law dictionary, it'll tell you that it does not embrace notes. And what we have that they're calling money is a Federal Reserve note, which means it's an IOU. It's something that was actually put in place until real money returns into circulation, which will probably never happen. Real money was gold and silver. Congress was actually never granted the ability to print paper money. They was only authorized to do gold and silver. And then Franklin Delano Roosevelt seized all of the real money, and he made it illegal to have gold and silver at those, you know, times in 1933. They came out what was known as the money order, which means they took all real money out of circulations from the private side, which was gold and silver, and then replaced it what they call these greenbacks, the dollar bill, and so on and so forth.
That's the thing. The first time when you get your change back, you get silver in there. Is that considered money? If you get if you have coinage that has silver in there?
Well, a lot of that don't have real silver and stuff anymore. That's just the problem. I don't know if you're aware of it, but
Right. Put in their quarters, and you people go through there and they find that. Is that considered still?
Yeah, that is. That is. But I mean,
if you had that, what did you do with that?
Well, no, I mean, you want to hold on to it because that really doesn't lose its value. This is why so many people are going out now and trying to buy gold, because the gold is not losing its value like the dollar bill. The dollar bill has almost completely lost its value, but gold retains its value.
So the gold that they're buying, they're finding out that, what is it, tungsten, that when they actually, that there's something that's not 99.99 choice, it's not a choice, it's something else. Something else is there.
Yeah.
Something else is there. It's like gemstones. I said, leave all that stuff in Mother Earth. She needs to rise smoothly.
Right.
And so, leave it, I said, for those of us don't want to get back, I said, well, maybe your ride be bumpy.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So, I mean, with the whole acceptance for value, if one's exempted from levy, then, you know, they have the ability to discharge the public debts if it's done correctly. So, you know, it's just really a matter of studying it and really learning how the thing works before you go and do it. And I try and tell people that consistently, but most people, they don't really want to listen to that. They just like want to rush out and do it. But you should never do something that you're not comfortable with. You know what I mean?
You gotta understand it a couple of different ways.
Right.
You gotta understand it to comfort me, and I can look at it. when I found out that, I was like, wow, you know, I studied this thing in the 1980s, and I can't believe I even underlined it in my book, and this was, and I used to look at it, well, what's M1 and M1, you know, M1, M2, M3, and I just remember the outlines, but, you know, the answers, and I said, wow, this is amazing.
Right. One of the first books that I ever saw that in, there's this bookstore, like, you know, I grew up on Church Avenue in Brooklyn. There was this bookstore I used to always pass by, and it always had this book in the window called Cracking the Code. But I will always, I used to say, I wonder what's in that book. And one day I just decided to go in and look in that book, and that book had all of this stuff back then. And this is like in the 90s. So that was one of the first books that really ever came out and taught about this stuff.
So when you first, you know, I know I was reading your book, and I said, and I thank your wife, please thank her for me, because she really, you know, helped me go, you know, I was afraid to call, because I was like, everything is, you know.
Yeah.
The only one I need to fear is the one that takes the breath away and can keep it taken, you know?
Right.
And not all these crazy people with pizza. I said, you're going to die, me too. I said, may never make it back up in here, you know?
Right.
So, but if you do come back, you may come back as a weasel, you know, a bunch of roaches or whatever. So, I really appreciate the time, but I won't do what I'm supposed to do, because I want to reach out to the doctors and whatever, you know, the outcome, spirit knows, and the other side would be the different coupons that they sent, but it was terrible. They make you, I was like, when your signature makes a loan, so they don't have anything.
Right.
When I signed, I'm like, so how could I have found that abandoned account? How could I have got in there? And they keep offering me stuff. They offer me stuff way out there. I'm like, wow, you know, it's like, I'll be fine, and then I'll say, now I'm going to find that abandoned account, because, you know, I created something for you. And not only I created something for you, you're trying to come out there and get something for me, you know?
Right.
That I created that for you, and then you found, I'm just, That irks me. I'm so, that makes me livid. You know.
But I mean, that's what it is. But, you know, I gotta make another call, sister. So, you know, have you watched, like, you know what I would suggest to you is start watching my videos from the beginning to the end, because it'll make a little more sense.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, because there's a lot of information there that people don't. You know, they just look at the most recent videos. But if you look at the older videos, it starts teaching from the basics. So people would actually get a practical understanding of it. Then, you know, they will understand it more and more and more. Because, I mean, with law, words are specific. So one little word could just give it an entire different meaning.
It's important to watch from the beginning. Things change. Yes, I was... Because of, you know, panic, when, you know, when they present themselves, like you said, we'd be shaking in our homes.
Right, right.
You know enough that this is not right, but you don't know enough to how to properly respond without triggering more trouble.
Good. And that's what they capitalize on, though. They capitalize on your fear. Like, when the fear goes away, and once you go in once, you'll be like, wow, I should have said this, I should have said that. Then, you know, your confidence starts to build up. It's like, well, I'm not going to be afraid of these people. Because even if you're afraid, things still don't turn out good for you. So you may as well go in and fight the good fight. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's right. Fight the good fight of faith and lay hold of the truth.
Right.
And
yeah.
That's right. And also, some people don't, we wasn't understanding the Bible even. We did not look at it correctly.
Right.
And because sometimes you got to see it from the front side, the side, and the back side, and put those all together to get a complete understanding. But if you just go with it on the front side, you will miss all the other side.
Okay.
Okay, I won't keep you. I thank you so much. And I'm when I get my other, I get so-called notes together, so I can, you know, pass them on to you.
Okay. All right, sister. I'll talk to you. Be safe.
Okay.
All right, shalom.